Very much, Saddle. That's right. My name is TJ, and I am joined by That's Admirable. It's the last match of the day, and we got a doozy of a matchup. It's Sidonia taking on Knob Lord.
Yeah, Knob Lord, a player that not too many people happen to be familiar with in some situations, but a very strong player in his own right. I know I've faced him quite a few times on ladder, and he is a force to be reckoned with.
Oh, yeah. Also, a big thing to note here. This is a big matchup for the last one of the day. Sidonia, the reigning America's champion, making a repeat performance would be incredible for him. And Knob Lord is actually on the edge of the last call standings.
Yes.
So this is really important for him. He's actually right around that 8 to 10 spot. So he could get past. There we go. And no, he's actually down to 13. Man, I thought he had more points than that. Wow. But still, the difference between 13 and 8 is 12 points. For winning the America's Championship, or any championship for that matter, or getting second place, you get like 25 points.
Yeah, it's a huge deal for him to perform at this particular event. I mean, sort of in the same situation that Chalky was for this one. I mean, this is kind of a one chance for him, and then if he can manage to perform very well here but can't come away with a championship, he can still get enough points to secure himself that last call spot. So a lot on the line for the players in that top 16 vying for that last call.
And Knob Lord is one of those players who's what I think the Hearthstone Championship Tour is about. You know, the players that have been playing at the very edge of competitive play for a long time, but haven't had that sort of chance to push themselves into the spotlight. He's been sort of that ladder hero for many, many seasons, many, many months. He's also been an open tournament grinder. He's been in many different practice groups. He's a player that whenever I boot up my friends list, I always see him in top 100 very early on in the season. So he definitely puts in his work, and he's up against a tough opponent in Sidonia who has that deck lineup. The deck lineup.
We're talking about the Shaman, Druid, Warlock, Warrior deck lineup. And if you look at his decks more specifically, you can pretty much guess exactly what they are. It is Aggro Shaman. It is Dragon Warrior. It is Zoo Warlock with Doom Guards and a Sea Giant. And it is Yogg Token Druid. He's basically said, this is the best performing lineup. I'm going to bring what I think the best decks are and leave the beating it up to you.
Yeah. And Knob Lord is sort of taking a similar route, but he's going with sort of a more data-driven lineup. This is the lineup that Chalky also brought. That's sort of the lineup that a bunch of players in the Americas region got together, and they said, this is the lineup that mathematically should win in a field of decks that Sidonia brought. Of those decks that they saw people in the Europe preliminary bring, they saw a lot of people in Americas are probably going to bring it. So this is sort of putting it to the test. There haven't been many players with this lineup that have had much success throughout the day, but Knob Lord is one of those players that's left remaining in the upper bracket. So we're going to see if that Shaman ban strategy with the Temple Mage and with that Rogue are going to make a difference.
Yeah, the difference here between this one and the Chalky one is Chalky was playing Shaman in place of where the Druid was. Knob Lord kind of on the side where it's very surprising to see Shaman cut, but is running just like a very standard token Druid build as well. The difference being that rather than run Ancients of War, he's chosen to run Wisps of the Old Gods, akin to what Nostum was running earlier in the day. And then if you take a look at his Warrior deck, the Warrior deck is just way off the wall. But it being Warrior, most people just don't want to play against it.
Yeah.
He brought a Nazoth Warrior that has a copy of Youthful Brewmaster in it alongside some really top-end threats like the Sylvanas and with the Baron Geddon, and just a lot of unique stuff going on in the Warrior list.
Yeah, definitely cool to see the Emperor Thorsan into Youthful Brewmaster Nazoth. Is ridiculous in control mirrors, and also control warrior just does well, so people always ban it. So you talked about the difference being the druid over the shaman in sort of this style of lineup, but they sort of serve similar purposes. You're saying, well, I'm banning shaman anyway, so let me just those decks like shaman and druid and even hunter are sort of close in how their matchups go, so it's a comfort thing where it seems like Knob Lord feels more comfortable playing a druid than he would playing a shaman in a lineup where he's banning shaman.
Yeah, the thing that interested me the most about the druid pick over the shaman, because I actually think I favor the shaman one in that style of lineup, is given just where mage sits right now. Tempo mage is bringing Firelands Portal, tend to give druid a bit of a hard time. Freeze mage in general tends to give druid a bit of a hard time. We're no longer in the era of Force of Nature, Savage Roar, and healing for 10 with extra 5/5s and things of that nature. But the shaman deck's still very strong in its own right. I think it comes down to whether or not you anticipate lots of mages or if you anticipate lots of something else.
Yeah, and I guess he anticipated lots of something else. And like I said, this is the lineup where in that little bubble of statistics and spreadsheets, this is the lineup that is supposed to beat the really strong
the
lineup.
Fab Four.
The Fab Four, yeah, exactly. That's what I coined it as last week. It's supposed to beat the Druid. It's supposed to beat the Warlock. The weird deck, there's the Warrior, but you do have a lot of tools against the Warrior. You know, Rogue can be tough, really tough against Dragon Warrior, but the Temple Mage is actually pretty good, and the Druid is actually pretty good as well. So that's going to be the matchup to look out for, whether or not he can get early wins over the Warrior deck.
I must protect.
But other than that, I really like this, and we'll see if Noblord can take it.
Yeah, getting into game number one, Cydonia is going to be on Zoo Warlock, while Noblord is on the Yogg-Token Druid, and Innervate, probably the most important card, I'd say, versus the aggressive matchups, allowing you to power out some of your more massive threats. And just as you mentioned, he was a very calculated player. Right off the bat, he's counting on his hands.
Exactly, yeah. He's deciding over mulligans here. This is actually really tough. There are so many debates over keeps for Druid. Innervate, you mentioned, is sort of a must, but do you keep the spells, or do you look for big plays to make? I think Innervate Wrath is acceptable, and I was saying Swipe is sort of the one where it's on the fence, but he goes ahead and keeps it, going for a very reactive style of play. Picks up Wisp of the Old Gods, which seems to always make it into the opening hand in Druid today.
Only if they're playing on the feature, where they've tended to struggle with it.
Yeah.
Elsewhere, they're doing fantastic. I mean, we're in round eight, and the players are still here.
Exactly. So Cydonia opens up with Possessed Villager. Doesn't have the greatest of opening hands, but I feel like Warlock doesn't have many strong two drops anyway. Their power comes a lot in their one drops and their three drops.
And interesting they choose to go with Ardent Squire over the Forbidden Ritual. That's sort of like a really interesting game of chicken that takes place oftentimes, where is the Warlock willing to Forbidden Ritual before the Druid plays Swipe? Is the Druid willing to Swipe before they've seen Forbidden Ritual? And usually the first person to blink is that a disadvantage if each player has a copy of it?
Mm-hmm.
That's always my favorite thing to watch, is so many times one or the other looks great for either player, but they're thinking about that other card and they go, shaking their fist at the screen.
Yeah.
Like an old man trying to return soup at a deli.
You really pulled that one out of nowhere. Oh my goodness. I wasn't expecting it. I was like, where's he going with this? Where's he going with this? Okay. So are we going for Whispers of the Old Gods?
It looks pretty good to me. About the only thing that's bad is when your opponent has Knife Juggler or...
Time waits for no one.
Looks like about it.
That's about it. It does ruin your curve, so maybe he wants to smooth it out a little bit.
Yeah, you could definitely wait. I think the key here is just finding what turn it's best on, and that's clearly what Noblord is thinking about.
Mm.
What turn is it best to cast Wisp of the Old Gods? And it may be in three turns even at this point. Just going to choose to get value out of his hero power and wait for it. With this, with two Innervates and the coin, and this many tools at your disposal.
Support spells.
It's,
yeah.
The world is at your fingertips.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very predictable style matchup where you know exactly what your opponent's going to be doing. Doesn't have to navigate around tools like Ravaging.
And I can imagine Noblord is really going to take his time and think through all of his plays in this game because of the fact that this is his opportunity to sort of prove himself. You know, this is the last season. This is summer. He either makes it to the top eight and wins the championship there, or he gets high enough placement to secure his spot in the last call and makes it to that one and wins to get to the world championship. So definitely think through his plays. Now he's trying to, okay, if this turn I go with double Innervate Wisps.
No. Okay, let's try.
Next turn I can coin out Druid of the Claw.
Okay, if I hero power that, no, that doesn't work. If I Wrath instead, oh, jeez. Mm.
Yeah.
I love watching Noblord. This guy's great.
He's channeling his brain power.
That's the position I got caught in during the Winter Championships. Mm. I didn't even realize I was doing that.
Just happens.
Yeah.
Just happens.
Cydonia, you know, to talk about Cydonia's body language too, Cydonia's a player that really pays attention to card positioning from players' hands. He's always looking where the cards are coming from. Which cards did you draw? Did anything influence the way you played? But turn three, Wisp of the Old Gods, save coin in hand. This is going to be tough for Cydonia to crack.
Yeah. A lot of times you need to get a good early board position and dodge removal spells if you want to win in this matchup, because if you let a Druid get to even a decent position in a game, they're just going to run away with it because they're going to drop big stuff and you're not going to have answers to that big stuff. So
I tell you what, Knife Juggler would be good here, but the MK Boss still looking pretty good. He's going to add councilman alongside this. And Cydonia has to be focused on trading right now. There is just absolutely no world where he can afford to attack face at this point.
He's the one that has the stronger board position, so he's got to be the one dictating these trades. Definitely like it.
Yep, this is going to pan out very well for Noblord as well. It does set up a full clear available to him. He can fill up the board with the extra spawns from the Imp Gang boss, trade one Imp into the Flame Imp to leave it at 3-1, put one Imp into the Darkshire Councilman, swipe will clear the board, and the Imp Gang boss will not spawn because the board will be full. And I think that is almost exactly what Noblord was trying to set up.
And you clear the board with plays in your hand, you're going to be in a great spot. One thing, though, it does open up Forbidden Ritual for Cydonia. That's always something that you take into account when you're playing against Zoo Warlock, but it's not something you can always play around. Very nicely done.
Yes, very. I mean, that was honest. That's like textbook for Noblord there. Honestly, kind of looking at it in that spot, I wonder if Cydonia really looked at what Swipe would look like. The problem is if he leaves all that up and Savage Roar happens, he's just dead.
He is.
Yeah, so I think he has to just trade.
Yeah. Definitely the right call. So now Noblord, Druid the Claw is the play that he had set up for.
Yeah, this may change that a little bit because suddenly Power Overwhelming is looking mighty strong versus you with just all the extra 1-1s out. But, you know, forcing a Power Overwhelming here is totally fine as well.
Yeah. I mean, Noblord might even be on the plan of I'm just going to try and remove the board as much as possible.
Yeah, there is a copy of Gormok in Cydonia's build, so that could have really accounted into the way that Noblord chose to play this turn.
Okay, yeah.
You know, if he leaves a bunch of minions up and just plays Druid the Claw and runs into Gormok, that is a situation where the game could very easily snowball.
The interesting thing is we were actually casting a tournament with Cydonia just, you know, last week, even earlier this week, and he actually had a lot of situational cards in his Warlock deck. He's actually trimmed it up a bit. He's cut some of the situational ones. He still kept the Gormok, but he's definitely made it more streamlined and more consistent with those one drops.
He actually mentioned on Twitter that he went back and analyzed that particular match that he played versus Ostkaka and tried to refine what was happening there.
See, it was the same meta as it is now, so maybe that sort of gave him that little bit of an edge. He's like, wow, he said, I need to go and sort of rethink my game plan, maybe change up my decks a little bit. His Warrior deck changed a bit as well. He sort of cleaned him up for the current meta, and now he's back, and it looks like he's in a great spot. Sea Giant drawn. He knows that a swipe is gone. He's going to get a lot of value out of that.
Well, that Nourish is pretty darn good for Noblord. He doesn't – it looks – I don't know if that's a look of excitement or a look of anguish.
He's like, am I going to Nourish into mana?
Is this a Yogg-Saron? I've never Nourished for mana before. Oh, my gosh. I'm going to be so embarrassed if this doesn't work.
Yeah. I said, but I think it's right. Said 1, 2, 3 spells his turn. How many have I cast in this game? Like 6?
How many spells does it take to get to the center of a Yogg-Saron?
10. I mean, you can kill the center of it with about 10. Kills about everything with about 10.
I'm thinking Nourish for mana here. I mean, Yogg-Saron, when you're behind, and not like horribly behind, is pretty much the best Yogg-Saron.
Yeah.
And if this board state devolves into Cydonia playing Defender of Argus, that's going to be bad enough.
Yeah.
And so I think he's cycling here first.
Yeah, just to see if anything is going to change his line.
Yep.
Oh, swipe might change.
Oh, my gosh. And he can't even believe it. He's just like, what do I do? I mean, I guess. Yeah, here we go.
It's not the best swipe in the world, but the thing is,
it shuts off the Sea Giant.
It shuts off the Sea Giant, and also I think it's just better than all-inning on Yogg.
Ooh, that might be a game plan here for Cydonia.
All right, well, this is something that we talked about earlier. The Sea Giant plus Doomguard interaction is actually really rough. The Sea Giant, double Sea Giant version of Zoo became popular when board control didn't mean as much, when control decks were in style, because you could play Sea Giant and it was really tough for control decks to remove, and you could pile up the burn spells or like Power Bombing in your hand. But Sea Giant and Doomguard have a really weird interaction where Sea Giant is so situational. Oh my goodness.
I honestly don't know which one of these keeps. I imagine that pitching the Sea Giant's probably better for Cydonia, but I don't know if the Juggler or the Power Overwhelming really represents more value. And Noblord going to instantly play Emperor Thorson here. Really not much thought to this. That's really interesting that panned out so fast, because that Druid of the Claw looked mighty good.
Yeah, it did. It absorbs damage, and also it makes it so he has to have some type of damage to couple with it to actually kill the Druid of the Claw, because you're hero powering down the 1-1. So that I think that did have a lot of merit. I would like to see him think about that a little bit longer. But Emperor Thorsen sort of has a, hey, please kill me now sign on it.
Given what I've seen from Noblord so far, he probably just already had that draw calculated. We're like, man, Emperor Thorsen would be a really good draw right here. Mm-hmm. Oh.
Come on and slam. And welcome.
To Hearthstone.
To Hearthstone. Don't think that's how it went, but we'll run with it.
It's a modified version.
Modified version. So this does let him Yogg next turn, but I don't even know if that's what he wants. I mean, maybe.
Meanwhile, Cydonia is just the complete opposite. So many. Noblord's like so animated, and like all the emotions are coming out because this isn't the time where he wants to save any energy reserving. He just wants it all to be mental focus. And Cydonia, just steely resolve.
Cydonia looks like he's trying to fight. Sleep.
I really like the push here from Cydonia as well. The win condition for him is quite literally just dealing 13 more damage as quickly as possible. Mm-hmm. If he chooses to trade over that Emperor Thorsen, it doesn't really get much value from it. The Voidwalker's already blocking for the board. He's already gotten a discount from it. What's that second discount really going to do? Well, it's going to do this, but this isn't something that Cydonia could have avoided this turn by attacking Emperor Thorsen, really.
It's not at all. And Noblord is also setting up for, trying to force Cydonia to trade because he might be afraid that he'll just die.
Yeah.
This isn't the Ancient of War version. This is the more aggressively themed version with Wisps and Onyxia. And so he might be afraid that he'll be dead.
Yeah. If you look at his list specifically, it really boils down to Cydonia, I think, whether or not he's trading, to know how many Savage Roars were available in the list. Noblord happens to be running two copies of Savage Roar.
Two of them.
So this is something that he has to consider when making trades this turn.
So not the best options here.
Mortal Coil's pretty darn good.
Yeah.
That allows the Dark Peddler to trade up into that Druid of the Claw very nicely.
Yeah, it does. He also could have gone with like Possessed Villager, but
looking for another card here.
Yeah.
He needs something a lot better.
So is Doomguard an out? Okay, no, he didn't have enough mana. I was thinking, wow, that's a lot of damage actually. Six. But it wasn't enough anyway. So he's just gonna Forbidden Ritual and Noblord. He is
I mean I think he wanted to just avoid Yogging this turn, and he may not be able to. I mean, if he chooses to nourish here, There's no innervates left in the build, so
no
Yogg will be off the menu if that happens.
No swipes. No wraths.
Oh, yeah, he's used both wraths, too. Living Roots is like the only source of direct damage left?
He could pick up a Raven Idol. He does have two of those left, and he does not have faith in the Yogg-Saron. He's going to put his faith in the cards he chose to put in his deck.
Savage Roar, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 damage available. If Noblord picks up
second
Savage Roar or Feral Rage here, that'll be enough.
Oh!
And there's a second Savage Roar, and Noblord is going to secure game number one with just a little bit of luck. He's going to make a list and check it twice with his math. But guess what, Noblord? You've won the first one.
Rewarded for his sort of patience there, I think. A lot of players were just slam Yogg because they don't have faith in their own deck. You say, I don't have any swipes left. I don't have any wrath left. What am I going to pick up? But picks up the Raven Idol into the Savage Roar. And no Yogg today, but Noblord is going to pick up the win. And yeah, I like that
very
game.
Impressive fashion.
A fun game
from game number one from Noblord. I mean, this is kind of the thing I'm talking about too. I've sat on the other end of the computer versus a faceless opponent named Noblord, and he's very, very good. And every single time I'm walking away from the match, whether or not I won or lost, going, I'm not sure that I had an advantage this game.
I'm gonna wait a couple minutes to queue.
Yeah, and I really do. And kind of watching his reaction to the way he's playing and how mindful he is about it, it's really not much of a surprise at this point anymore. That game number one looked very strong from Noblord.
Cydonia can also wait a couple minutes to queue, but when he queues again, he's getting Noblord 100% of the time. So
yep.
Back to the drawing board for him as far as what he wants to do in this series. Druid was probably the deck that I was a little bit afraid of, because it's that one that's sort of the fringe one. It's the one that in this particular lineup is the one that might be struggling, especially since Druid's done pretty bad today.
Yeah,
I'll go ahead and say it.
The deck has a lot of high variation in it just because of its natural failure rate. When you draw nothing but high cost cards and no utility, you just don't do anything and you die.
Yeah.
And that's basically where you find win rate against Druid, is just when they're not doing anything. Mm-hmm. But that's one of the reasons why you've seen them kind of tailor to more of this Power of the Wild style strategy, where they just want stuff to do in the early game and then hope that their end game is enough to get it done. In this situation, Knoblord kind of just drew a really nutty hand. But, you know, if you navigate it that well, it's like almost 100% chance to win when you get in those situations.
We've seen some players today have those nutty hands and not win.
Right.
Looking back to, like, that Chalky series earlier on where Teray had a fantastic opening with Druid and wasn't able to get it done. Looking at even Lead Paint earlier on in the day, who had a really great draw in one of the games against Druid, couldn't get it done. So it's not an automatic win by any means. And when you do get those Innervates, Fandral, Vile Teacher stuff early on. So Knoblord now has Tempo Mage left and the Rogue deck. Rogue maybe not has struggled today on the matches we've seen on stream, but there's quite a few players left in the tournament that do a Rogue. Rogue in the Europe preliminary was incredible. It was one of the highest win rate decks, and also a couple people that were in the top eight that will be making it to the championship were playing Rogue.
A lot of that has to do with just kind of the matchups that are panning out right now, too. If you bring Rogue, I feel like you're often banning Shaman away from your opponent's lineup. Rogue happens to do fairly well versus Warrior. Against Dragon Warrior, it's a fairly even matchup. Against all the other Warriors, you're typically really favored. And against a deck like Druid, Rogue typically performs very, very well.
Yes. All right, so moving into the next matchup, Sidonia once again throws out the Zoo Warlock, and Knoblord switches over to the Rogue. So Tomb Pillager, great card. But against Zoo, sometimes a little slow, but Tomb Pillager is definitely always on your mind as far as keeps in the mulligan.
Yeah, against Zoo in particular, it might be the matchup where Tomb Pillager is not necessarily an automatic keep. I feel like in just about every other matchup except for Zoo and, of course, the Shaman, which he's banned away, that this is a deck where Tomb Pillager is basically an automatic keep. And in this one, it's not going to be any different. And he picks up Backstab and Shiv to go along with it. So with this particular Rogue deck, we're looking at two copies of Conceal, one Deadly Poison, one Journey from Below, one copy of Shiv, and it's got the Questing Adventure package alongside one Shadow Strike rather than the two that Chalky was running. But after that, just tops out with regular minions. So we'll see if he can get the job done here. And right away, picks up that one Deadly Poison, and that is a fantastic draw when you're facing down Voidwalker.
It is. And I like his patience here. Voidwalker is not that great of a threat. He has the Deadly Poison. There's no need to go ahead and backstab this now. And if he picks up an SI7 agent next turn, he can couple that even better. So patience. Okay. Well, that changes things.
Look at Knoblord's reaction. He just laughs. He's like, that's the best draw. That's the one I wanted.
That's the chosen one.
You were the chosen one.
Yeah, the difference is we saw Chalky earlier opt to go for one SA7 agent, double Shadow Strike.
I think it's a nod to what he expected to face.
Yeah.
He already said that he expected Drew to struggle. I'm sorry, for Zoo to struggle. And I think his lineup already performed fairly well versus Zoo. And so kind of hedging your bets with the Rogue deck to make it stronger versus the matchups I think he was anticipating. Not necessarily a bad idea. So Knoblord obviously going to go with the miracle SI7 agent that's been drawn. And outside of Abusive Sergeant, and even in that case, given his hand, not too much for him to be worrying about here. Sidonia has got to be sweating this.
It is. That is correct. Darpeller can pick up an Abusive Sergeant here and doesn't find it.
Soulfire's not bad either. I mean, you almost certainly have to Soulfire this SI7 agent, or you're going to just lose your whole board.
Their Defender of Argus can be really good against Rogue, but I think you're okay with risking that discard just to gain control of a board that's gotten a little bit away from you. Knoblord did keep a card in his mulligan that he hasn't used yet. Against Zoo, there's not many things that could be.
At this point, I feel like it's almost exclusively Tomb Pillager.
Yeah, it could also be
Backstab.
It could be second Backstab or Shadow Strike.
Yeah.
So you might feel like you need to Pixel Fire and...
It could be Preparation. I mean, keeping Preparation versus Zoo is not an uncommon thing.
Okay. But you mentioned earlier Sidonia is really good at reading hands, so maybe he... Okay, well, I was thinking maybe he picks a Soulfire and waits.
Yeah,
but
so...
This time he just goes flame him.
Yeah, for this spot right here, what Sidonia has kind of said is that he feels like damage is going to be his major win condition this game. It's not going to be able to grind up Knoblord's resources in the face of Backstab SI7 agent. That's probably a good call. It's very difficult to kind of value through those kinds of starts. So Cydonia got to start the push, I think, a little bit earlier than he wanted. So I think he understands that he's probably at a disadvantage this game, but this is just the way it's got to be.
Well, we'll see if it's going to work out for him. This SI7 agent now has room to make value trades. But we'll see if that's going to be the case. My first instinct was just to slam Tomb Pillager and value trade. Into the 1-1 and kill it, because whether or not a 1-1's alive or a 2-2's alive is the same thing. It's still going to get another minion that has to go into it. You don't get to re-dagger, but your hand is full of sort of cheap spells. So you can go ahead and do that. And yeah, he goes ahead and makes that play. Wow, I think this is the strongest line.
Value trades here too. He wants Power Overwhelming to kind of be as worse as it possibly could be. And this was certainly the way to do that. And Cydonia finds Doomguard.
Yeah, Doomguard. And also this makes Defender of Argus not punish him at all. The only punish it is, effectively, is you take two more damage than you would have if your opponent decides to go face.
Yeah, it makes your trades a little bit awkward. I mean, you leave around a 5-1 Tomb Pillager. But if you take a look at the way that Noblord's next turn's lining up with both Shadow Strike and Phantom Knives and Shiv, all his options, I'm not really sure Cydonia has a play that can punish what Noblord has in hand right now. He just almost has a perfect range.
Why sometimes Rogue, even though for a while Rogue was considered incredibly weak against Zoo at the very beginning of sort of Standard. Rogues were tending to build the deck a little bit greedy, and they were trying to build up more towards control, but Ghostface, and he's going to get punished. This is going to be a full board clear for Noblord plus some.
Yeah, but even going to keep around the SI7 agent, very wise to use the resources this way. Life total is still a bit of a resource. He knows that Cydonia is running Doomguards rather than running Leeward Jenkins, so the burst potential is way, way lower. It's very hard to couple Doomguard with Power Overwhelming. It's very easy to couple Leeroy with it, though. So unless Cydonia is able to actually stick minions to the board, Power Overwhelming is damage that Cydonia basically just doesn't have access to.
Yeah. All right, Gormok the Impaler has been picked up. Mentioned that card earlier. When that card's good, boy, is it good.
Yes.
But when it's bad,
it's like a bad Dark Iron Dwarf.
Yeah, but you, as a Zoo Warlock, you don't really want to be spending four mana on a 4-4.
Yeah, here we go. And Cydonia, again, he just recognizes that this is the way he's going to win, is by pushing damage. Noblord almost recoils from it, too. Sap is not a very good play onto a Doomguard, but it looks like Shadow Strike and Trade In is pretty darn good.
It is, but another thing is he needs to find more resources because he's going to have to start. Oh,
wow.
Well, that's a way to start pushing damage.
And that's going to push damage mighty fast. This is 9 a turn cranking out for Noblord right now, and he has Sap and Phantom Knives. What is he weak to at this point? I guess a Knife Juggle.
Yeah.
Which Cydonia happens to have a Knife Juggler in hand. So this is like the turn for Cydonia. He needs to pick up anything to couple with this and try to get this juggle. Flame Imp's not what he's looking for.
If he misses the juggle, well, he's dead, but I guess he can't really afford to not take that risk. And he's also just getting himself really low. And Noblord, he's going to go ahead and pray. All right, let's see the juggle of his life. Can he nail it?
This is so important.
Got him.
I think that juggle may put Cydonia one step closer to staving off an elimination round here.
Yeah. But, I mean, that Flame Imp is probably going to eat a sap, and that thing is not going to be playable again.
Right.
And you're at this point, there's no other good sap targets. You can't really play around Defender of Argus at this stage. Noblord.
Something interesting to note is that there's no Leeroy Jenkins in Noblord's list. It is strictly reliant on
Questing Adventure,
getting a board presence and pushing from there. So the sap, like you said, very strong onto the Flame Imp here. But it's got to be Phantom Knives first. And Azure Drake, if he draws that in the opposite order with the Sap and the Azure Drake, I think that he just outright wins the game.
Yeah. Well, he's at 6 health. Cydonia has a Doomguard left in his deck.
Cydonia just shook his head, too. That's the first bit of emotion we've seen from him.
Yeah, and it goes as far as shakes his head. That's his emotional range.
I honestly don't know if he can life tap here. I mean, going to 4 means you're dead to Eviscerate.
I suppose he's probably...
Oh!
That is bad.
That's the worst draw in the deck. By far. I think that's game.
Well, yeah. I mean, he has to draw Doomguard into
Abusive Sergeant. He has to draw literally Doomguard into Abusive Sergeant.
He has no Power Overwhelmings left.
How does he couple that? I mean, it's very hard. He'd have to fade
Duke
the discard.
Tap, how overwhelming.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that'd be possible.
He's got three health.
It has to be the perfect way. So Defender of Argus can actually buy him another turn here.
Tim King boss, Defender of Argus.
I'm curious if Noblord has just a way directly to get around this. I mean, Eviscerate's going to kill him outright. Gadgetzan Auctioneer is a very, very weird draw here.
This is going to be a lot closer than we thought it'd be.
That Defender of Argus was a very big pickup. I mean, Noblord can't afford to use his life as a resource anymore.
So Gadgetzan Auctioneer has to be better, because if you pick up any spell, it's in a couple with it. So he needs a spell or burn.
I'm ready for a miracle, TJ.
Oh!
He's like, ah, that's not too bad.
Oh!
Prepping to prep, the pro play that everyone wanted to see. Ban of Knives, not a bad one.
And it's also free, so he still has another chance to pick up lethal, but more importantly, he removes a little bit of damage from the board, so he takes out one of these win conditions.
Backstab. That can be used on one of the imps at least. Draws him another card.
I mean, at this
Journey Below is going to pick up another card.
Conceal.
Conceal picks up another card. This is getting really, really weird.
SI7 agent.
That can take care of the board position. So he's going to just handle the Defender of Argus, trim Power Overwhelming and Abusive Sergeant as outs, as well as trying to trim into any Defender of Argus. This is Doomguard and Doomguard alone for Cydonia.
Yeah, he can't do it.
Forbidden Ritual?
Oh my gosh!
My goodness. Oh my gosh!
A 1-4 to win the game.
This is unbelievable.
No way. Did it go face? Oh my goodness. That was close.
Wow, what an intense game between these two. It is down to the wire.
Oh,
you can take
man.
A look at why these two are touted as such good players. Cydonia being the defending champion for Americas right now, and kind of just the way that I've talked up Noblord so far. I mean, these are literally down to the last card deciding it, and that's kind of just the way it works. When you have two strong players who have good draws, you play the best you can, and the cards decide the rest.
Ridiculous. There was the Knife Juggler onto the Tomb Pillager. Had to hit it. Wasn't able to hit the second juggle, but put himself in a position where he had those outs. Stuck with two flame ups in his hand, but a really crazy set. And now Noblord has three chances to win with Temple Mage. Temple Mage, I think, struggles a little bit against Zoo, but the matchup is so much better nowadays.
Yeah.
At least the early game. You sort of cut Flame Strike now. He did for Firelands Portal. That seems to be.
Which actually makes it a little bit weaker against Zoo.
Makes it a little bit weaker against Zoo, but you have more early game tools than you once did. You know, you run a lot of one drops. Mirror Image can buy you time. Arcane Blast is a great tool against faster decks.
Yeah, sort of the way I'm seeing this is that the sacrifice that you make against Zoo isn't really that big of one, mm-hmm. since it was hard enough to get to a favorable Flame Strike anyway.
Sure.
So having the Firelands Portal strengthens your Warrior matchup, specifically Dragon Warrior, and it really strengthens your Druid matchup. And those are two decks that are both in Cydonia's lineup right now. So he can kind of sacrifice that Warlock game with the Mage and still have two very favorable matchups afterwards. And that's where that Tempo Mage is trying to fit for Noblord. And kind of as you watch it unfold and play against what other players have brought, it just makes a lot of sense the way that the lineup is targeting things.
It does, yeah. And so far, that lineup from Noblord, that sort of expertly crafted to take out the best decks, the Fab Four, as we've come to call it, is working out. It have been close matchups, but they've been ones where, you know, it's been calculated from Noblord's perspective. And now he's down to that last deck. This is the one that is sort of the new kid on the block. This is the Tempo Mage deck that does have new cards in it, so it can't be extensively tested, at least to the point of the decks that are currently touted as being really powerful. And also, Tempo Mage has always been sort of an inconsistent deck. And so we're going to start it off. Can Noblord close this out? A big win for him. It gets him one step closer, not only to the America's Championship, but also to that ever-important last call standing should he not make it in.
Yep. And Cydonia, if he wants to repeat his championship performance, he has to win three straight games. Otherwise, he is out of the tournament.
Crucial. Cydonia came into the America's Championship as a pretty heavy underdog, I'd say. Nobody really knew who he was. And he really hasn't done too much since then. But in every tournament that I've seen him in, I've come in thinking, Cydonia, is he going to do it again? Was was the America's Championship, was it like sort of a fluke? And it hasn't been. I've seen him play, and he has impressed me time and time again. So
it is going to be hard for Knobloor to win this one. That is a stunning hand from Cydonia. Two copies of Alex Straza's Champion. Slam, which happens to shine in the Tempo Mage matchup, and Twilight Guardian. If he manages to draw a dragon here, this hand is about as perfect as it gets.
It is, yeah.
Like Fiery War Axe in place of one of the two cost cards might make it a little bit better. For the life binder. This is going to be a lot of damage pouring in.
Corcoran Elite, not so much. It does die very easily, and the only thing it really trades up to is Azure Drake, and that's not really a trade that you usually want to make.
Yeah, it's good to just push damage, though. I mean, that's one of the reasons why the Warrior is at such an advantage, is because they can just push a lot of damage, and it's hard for Freeze Mage to recover through that, especially in the face of Ragnaros, in the face of Grommash, in the face of 9/9s for 6 mana, and in the face of a Steady Shot that's freshly drawn from a Sir Finley Murgleton.
There is some merit to other things here. There is merit to the lesser heal, because board presence matters. But the way his hand plays out, he's got just a lot of raw damage.
Right.
He's going to put him really low really early. So Steady Shot sort of fits his hand a little bit better.
Yeah. A lot of times, the Finley in Dragon Warrior is so particularly interesting because all the hero powers mean different things based on the way your hand is. And because his hand's so aggressive, the Steady Shot is just far and away the best one here.
Indeed. All right, well, there is an opportunity for Knobloor to make a power play. He can hide a Cult Sorcerer and a Sorcerer's Apprentice behind some mirror images. And that could open up the door with a 2-mana Arcane Intellect next turn, plus already a 1-mana spell in hand. He might be able to swing the board in his favor.
This is certainly an excellent spot. I wonder what the whoops is for. I don't really... Looks pretty good to me, Knobloor. He sees something we don't. You know, in his head too, he's like, "Oh my gosh, I can't believe I did that."
Maybe he wanted to play Arcane Missiles, but you have a very little chance of killing anything on the board, and maybe while it's free, and also while it has spell power, it's okay. But I just like going for the 2-mana Arcane Intellect into just board clears here. Fireball doesn't really help him, but he's got to make the choice if he... Ooh, this is tough.
Yeah,
it's got to be Arcane Intellect, though, I feel.
Well, it could be Fireball. I mean, Fireball does effectively buy you an extra minion here. You could just Fireball the Corcoran Elite, and it keeps a minion on board. But I think there's also a lot to be said about digging with Arcane Intellect right now. I mean, picking up Arcane Blast, Frostbolt, another Arcane Missiles, a lot of draws are very strong for Knobloor right now.
Well, this trade means that it's almost... certainly Fireball, but he's going to go with a 5-damage Arcane Missiles. He might be able to pick up stuff with a ping as well. These need to hit minions, though. Oh my gosh.
Wow. If all of those had hit minions, I don't think Knobloor could have come away losing this game.
No.
And this is the spot where he's going to start pushing damage himself. That's another thing that's really important, is against Dragon Warrior, you have to find an opportunity to push damage. And really seize it at the first time it comes up, because they don't give you a lot of time. They have very powerful finishers. So finding every opportunity to chip away is paramount.
Yeah. So Cydonia, probably the way his hand's going, he thinks he's going to win late. So he's going to just go ahead and remove everything from the board. Usually removing those minions from Temple Mage gets rid of a lot of their steam. But with the way Temple Mage has been going, you know, including Firelands Portal, they can go one for one very easily. It can turn into a value deck really quickly, and
decent draws. But Knobloor's looking for Flame Waker. He's looking for Azure Drake. He's looking for the sort of the meat of his deck at this point. He's gotten past the early game at a relatively safe position. So at this point, it's going to boil down to minions. And if Cydonia just keeps drawing charge minions, that's the worst case scenario for Knobloor.
He's already at 15. And now, since Temple Mages don't have any way to heal, and I don't think so, is there any 5-mana minion that...
Mirror Image is about the only way that you can heal.
But Draconic Crusher is activated for the rest of the game.
Yes, and it's a very big problem for Knobloor at this point. I can't think of a 5-mana minion that actually restores health outside of Battle Cries.
Yeah, not off the top of my head, but...
There's always Yogg-Saron, but...
Yeah,
he's got to get there first. I mean, the concern is getting to turn 10 most of the time.
Yeah, especially with Steady Shot. He has a not a, if he keeps removing the board, not a short clock.
Wow, but we're building more attention. This is really, wow!
Whoa.
What a draw from Noblord. That was the perfect draw.
That's a sick. Well, I mean, he could have had Arcane Blast as well.
Sure. The plan here was to build board tension and then find a way to take advantage of the fact that Cydonia would have pushed damage there. And so he's calculating how much damage he pushes with his hand, and also alongside the Azure Drake. But given the way that Cydonia has played this game, I'm not sure that Azure Drake would have stuck around. So if that's the case, then the Azure Drake is just a 4/4 taunt that draws a card, which Noblord is also okay with.
What a good call to make there. I feel like most players would have just like forgotten Torched and pinged the face or something along those lines. Now Noblord has a chance to really punish, picks up an Arcane Blast. He can clear the board here and leave his Azure Drake up. He's got Fireball, Frostbolt, and Arcane Blast.
This is perfect for Noblord. He just needs a little bit more gas, and he's going to have time to do it.
Yeah.
Cydonia's Ragnaros is hitting next turn, but Noblord should be able to clear that if he plays his cards right here. Like, the Azure Drake's probably attacking first.
Yeah.
And whoa! I'm really surprised by that. Oh, I bet he's going to save health on the Azure Drake by doing it this way. This is really smart, actually. So this way, he gets to evaluate whether or not he's killing this Twilight Drake this turn. And given the hits, now he gets to trade over it cleanly. Just lots of hero power face. And I suspect he should keep the Frostbolt here, because if he uses the Frostbolt, he's healing his Azure Drake effectively for two and getting the same amount of damage out of it. I think I would like to see him save it, because Ragnaros or Grom is quite literally going to be the ways he loses this game.
And he actually just goes face. He realizes that he might be on a burn plan to win.
That's another thing, too. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Well, he's got 16 damage next turn. But he's going to have to face on Ragnaros first, and you can see the reaction there from Noblord.
Oh my gosh!
Suddenly not clearing that Ragnaros, or not clearing that Twilight Guardian looks a lot worse.
Yeah. That's going to be a decision that could end up haunting him.
He can't play everything this turn.
I sort of like the thought behind it, though. What other card in the deck punishes him for the play that he made?
Grom is still pretty bad.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah. Grom.
Grom and Ragnaros are the two heavy hitters. But the thing about it, Cydonia had one card in hand and one draw to make that happen. It's very likely he doesn't have one of those cards.
And if he just plays a minion, Noblord just effectively can have his way with the entire game here. And now he's faced with a really tough situation. I don't think he can afford to kill this Rag. He might feel like he can.
I'm looking at Flame Waker Fireball and just hope, maybe? That seems awful.
So if he Flame Waker's Fireballs, he puts Cydonia at 12 at the highest, and that doesn't even let...
No, I'm thinking Fireball, the Rag is probably got to die.
He's got to hit... Then he would have to hit both of his.
Ooh, I don't mind this either. So if he Flame Wakers and Frostbolts the Twilight Guardian, sees where the juggles land, and then could potentially kill the Ragnaros afterwards.
Okay.
And so if the Ragnaros hits the Flame Waker here, he gets 8 extra health. If it hits face here, he gets to keep a Flame Waker. Well, he doesn't get to keep a Flame Waker, but...
Yeah, and I don't know. I think that's probably going to spell the end with Steady Shot being thrown in. This is going to be 10 damage push to the face. As long as if the Ravaging Ghoul is still, if either of these are still on the board, it's...
Yeah, that's just going to do it. Noblord doesn't have the cards left in this to fight back. I mean, just the hero power is going to knock him down.
Oh, my goodness!
But he can't live. He can't live. He's one mana off.
Wow.
This has been an unbelievable series between these two.
I hate that, Admirable. I hate when Yogg-Saron comes in a miracle situation and he's one mana away.
You know, I look at that and I wonder... If Noblord had just attacked the Twilight Guardian there, what would have happened?
I don't know.
It is just a completely different game.
It is, yeah. I'm trying to think of, he's trying to play into the fact that Cydonia had very little resources and hoping that Cydonia was going to draw just a minion that didn't have any effect on the board, in which case, that's the right play.
Yeah, he's looking for Cydonia to draw like Blackwing Corruptor, not Drakkonid Crusher, Ragnaros, or Grommish. Basically anything else but those.
Exactly. And he didn't. And so maybe in a situation like that where both players are low on resources, it is better to play the value game and try and play around sort of that worst possible case scenario. Maybe he felt like he was on too short of a clock with Steady Shot being sort of that equalizer. but it's definitely a decision that is tough to try and calculate which one's actually the best in that specific scenario. But Knobloid still has two chances remaining, and that was not the hardest matchup, I don't think. Maybe Zoo's going to be hardest, but that's one of the hardest.
Yeah, I think Zoo's definitely going to be his hardest matchup, but with the Warrior, this one kind of came down to just the power of Cydonia's draw. I mean, he had double Alexstrasza's champion and a slam and a Twilight Guardian. It just doesn't really get much better than that when you're playing against Tempo Mage. Every single one of those cards gets you value and contests a card from your opponent.
Yeah.
That's like the winning, that's the winning play against Tempo Mage, just to do that over and over again.
Yeah. So we'll see what Cydonia is going to throw up for the next one. But the big thing remains here is he's still got to win two more games in a row.
Yeah.
So
and that's, this is for his tournament life as well.
For his tournament life, this is a lower bracket match, and both these players have a lot riding on this. Cydonia is really just trying to prove that he is one of the world's best by qualifying twice in a row for a championship and potentially winning twice in a row. And Knobloid, he's just trying to get there. He's just trying to get to one. He needs to either secure a spot in the championship or secure his spot in the last call, either which would be huge for his Hearthstone career.
All smiles from Knobloid at the start here. I can't stress it enough. Love his attitude so far.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely seems like a guy who just likes playing some Hearthstone. Not likes bad, thinking critically about cards.
Not a bad opening hand from Knobloid. Would like a few more tools to deal with this. But Cydonia is going to be working with quite a bit of early utility and then looking to secure Defender of Argus. Defender of Argus is one of the reasons why this matchup is so, so very difficult.
It really is. So it looks like we're just going right away.
Yep. I mean, picks up another Arcane Intellect. So being able to just Arcane Intellect into Arcane Missiles and then Arcane Intellect again, that's kind of one of the ways that Knobloid could win this. Card economy is a real thing that Tempo Mage has to fight in this matchup. It's fighting against the natural card advantage engine that Warlock has with Hero Power. So it's definitely a tough one.
All right, well, Arcane Intellect, if this picks up another Arcane Missiles or an Arcane Blast, it's going to be pretty good. But
now
this
one's, it's real options at this point.
Whoa. So Arcane Intellect, if it picks up an Arcane Blast, that would be almost infinitely better. Not infinitely better. That's really excessive. I just, it came out of my mouth and I was like, whoa, TJ.
Slow down.
Back up.
Yeah, he's going to check and see if Hero Power is on the menu this turn.
While the most minions are on the board, that's usually going to be the best.
Yeah, that will definitely spell Hero Power at this point. So now he can keep this Possessed Villager isolated. He just saw an Abusive Sergeant. He can keep that at bay and then roll into Frostbolt and Arcane Intellect. And so Cydonia picks up Flame Imp here, and that happens to be one of the worst minions he can draw right now, I think.
I really like the very fast use of Arcane Missiles. Arcane Missiles is one of the most situational cards in Tempo Mage. So getting value out of it while you can is really tough. Picks
oh
up an Arcane
my
Blast already.
Gosh. Knobloid, this is a fantastic start. I mean, he might run away with this game at this point. Cydonia has got one card left, and the Sorcerer's Apprentice is going to attack for three more damage. This Sorcerer's Apprentice has done so much work this game.
It definitely has. And Dark Peddler, I don't think Cydonia could have asked for much better. He possibly has a chance to pick up a Mortal Coil, but doesn't.
These are not very strong options. Honestly, the Shield Bear is not bad. But something to consider in this matchup is a lot of Tempo Mages, they don't run Acolyte of Pain. And so Shield Bearer is pretty decent if you can load a Defender of Argus on it. It's just a very inefficient so tool of damage that the mage basically just doesn't want to kill. Mm-hmm. It's like, am I going to Frostbolt this 1-5? Like, what am I doing?
Frostbolt my 1-5 and attack into it with my 3-2. So many resources used, and that's a weak turn. And Knobloid, his eyes perk up. He's like, whoa, if you did that...
Oh my gosh.
Arcane Intellect, Arcane Blast, and a ping clears the board again. Sorcerer's Apprentice can get in for another 3 damage, and he picks up 2 cards.
I think developing the Blood Mage is a little bit better than the Arcane Intellect.
Okay.
You're investing into a damage on the board at this point. Now there's multiple things that Cydonia has to think about when he's trying to nab board presence here. Just everything that Knobloid can to push damage and make it awkward for Cydonia. His opening was so strong. So, I mean, Cydonia's down to 15 at this point. That's not very many more life taps. And the mage deck is stuffed full of burn spells. He has to Doomguard the Sorcerer's Apprentice.
That's not good. And
there's going to be more minions here.
Sure.
Just play. Just put them on the board.
Put them on the board and hit go. Ah. I like the minions a little bit better, but
oh my goodness.
I don't like the minions better anymore.
Noblord has drawn arcane missiles. He's drawn both arcane blasts. He's drawn both frostbolts. He's not even going to frostbolt here. He's actually just gonna push. He says, you know what? With Firelance Portal in hand, I think I can just deal you more damage than you can deal me.
He's at 30 still. He knows that Sidonia has very little resources. He's going to have to keep tapping. At some point in the game, a fireball draw is just going to end it.
And Sidonia does not have an option. He cannot attack this Blood Mage right now. He has to push face damage right now. Every single point of damage that Sidonia draws is massively important. And another mirror image to hide behind. And now at this point, Noblord can just kind of fall back and go, you know what? I can frostbolt this Doomguard.
I can win this match. I'm empowered.
You're good enough.
Mm.
You're smart enough. Doggone it, people like you.
That's what he's telling himself right now. He's like,
except for that one guy. No brainer frostbolt here.
Much in the ways of things that that Sidonia can do to come back in this game.
Yep. Acolyte of Pain, drop the mirror image, and we're about to giddy up on some damage here. Noblord is in full control right now on Sidonia. When you're at 12 against a deck that's chocked full of burn, that Warlock hero power becomes a liability. It's a pretty strong pickup, though.
Yeah.
And you're going to see Noblord just go for face here. So when Sidonia loads up this board, it's quite literally just going to be Forgotten Torch the face to Sidonia, ping him down to 6 on the 7 mana play, and then look for ending the game afterwards. So it might be Firelance Portal instead.
I think Firelance Portal might be a little bit better, because then you can just Forgotten Torch ping the face next turn, and you have a 5-5, but looks like he's just going to go for this one.
Well, if Sidonia's not going to taunt up this turn, that's a different story, because now he gets that extra damage from the Acolyte of Pain. So unless Sidonia Dark Peddlers into a heal here, there's no way he can win the game. And now that he didn't draw Dark Peddler here, Noblord is going to take the series 3-1 and knock out the America's Spring Champion.
We won't be seeing a repeat performance of Sidonia, and this is one of those flexibilities of Firelance Portal. Sometimes it can hit the face for 5, and that's enough.
Yep.
Just an extra burn tool in the deck. He even draws a Roaring Torch, but Firelance Portal for the style points. See what you get. Noblord, really great stuff. Oh, that's probably the worst. We're asking what the worst fire drop was. That one's the worst, but it doesn't matter. Really great performance by Noblord moving on through the lower bracket.
Yeah, I mean, a very strong draw from the Tempo Mage. You know, no matchup is truly unwinnable. With the right cards and the right use of them, you can get through anything. And just all of his tools lined up so good versus what Sidonia had, and he navigated the matchups expertly.
Yep. It's one of those things where if you put yourself in a good enough position, your last deck, which arguably the weakest in that with two probably weak matchups with Dragon Warrior and Zoo Warlock, he gave himself 3 chances to win. Took him 2, but that's all it took. And Noblord moves on, so really great for him. And moving further up, so the further he moves up, the more Hearthstone Championship Tour points he gets. Even if he doesn't qualify, that's the closer he gets to the last call.
Yep, every single win for him is paramount at this stage, and a very strong performance. After watching that one, he might be the player to beat this tournament.
Indeed, yeah. It's been a fun day. That was the last match we're going to broadcast today. We got to see a lot of new cards. Ivory Knight made an appearance with its Murloc or anything can happen draws over and over again. Those are some fun matches. Got to see Firelands Portal at the end. It's been a pleasure, Admirable. But for some wrap-up thoughts on the day and to give you some final updates, let's check in with Dan at the Blackboard.
Thank you very much, TJ and Admirable. I believe you guys are correct, although I argue that Starving Buzzard is a little bit of a weaker 5-drop, but I guess it's relative because you get to draw a beast. Speaking of beasts, we have a beast from the Northeast. It is Brian Kibler. What's up, man?
Not too much. You know, it was great to see a lot of, you know, sweet action. The Karazhan cards in particular showing up big in a lot of the matches today, so yep. Fun stuff.
Absolutely. We've had a lot of fun actions. Take a look at all the players once again for a big overall snapshot for anybody who wasn't able to tune at the beginning. We had 168 players to start, and now we're down to 26. You guys saw updates on Lemurian, Rosti, Brian Kibler's pick, still holding out strong. Hot and Meowth, of course, winning a very important series over Just Saiyan, who was eliminated in the lower bracket.
But overall, this has been an absolute bloodbath. So many crossed off names. You know, this is a long and grueling tournament for lots of these players. Tons of rounds, and only so many. In the end, 8 can come out on top.
Yeah, that's right. Over in the U.S. East, Hemi Powered was just eliminated, I believe, by Yo It's Flow, so he's still in the tournament, too. That is the second pick that is currently alive, and that is by Admirable.
And we did just see Noblord win on stream. Phone Tap Muzzy from Luminosity, and Joster, one of the competitors from the top 8 of the Spring Championship, still in the running.
Yeah, Joster eliminated Saiyan. Sidonia did just lose his match on stream as well. Latin America, unfortunately, seems to have dropped almost every single player except for a couple. We do have a few players still in it, but overall, maybe we still have space for one of them to sneak through to the top 8.
And a few Tavern Healers still in. We saw Appa on stream with a convincing win over Terrence M earlier, and Timma, the Fireside champion from 2014. So still in the mix.
That was a bar as opposed to Appa. I believe.
Oh, yeah. I missed it there.
It was, or Abra, I'm not sure exactly how to pronounce it.
I just like the flying beast from Avatar.
Right. Okay. Well, as with such, before we close out the day, we have to check in with the predictions. As you see through our board, we have 2 players who are in and 2 players who are out. So, Kibler, if you will, you have the blood ceremony.
Sorry.
Marked by the X, frozen as well. It's taken down. Wow. So symbolic in many ways. Kibler breaking the chalk. He's been going to the gym too much as well. That's our predictions. Only 2 remain, but how are your players doing? Let us know. Hashtag HCT on social media, or if you missed any of the exciting moments, we've been posting it, all the small videos and the GIFs as well. So play Hearthstone on Twitter or Facebook.com/Hearthstone. Tomorrow, we're going to begin once again at 10 a.m. Pacific here at twitch.tv/playHearthstone. So from Frodan, Kibler, and everyone else here, thanks so much for watching. And we'll see you guys tomorrow to see our top 8 for the America's Championship. We'll be right back.